And on and on I could go. Hi guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison. Welcome to the inaugural edition of, look at this, the Monday Guitar Show. Now, if you've been a regular viewer of the streams that we've been doing on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel, you'll know exactly what's going on here. But in case you're a new friend, hey, welcome on board. We're going to hang out and talk about the guitar, which is the thing that we do on Mondays. Now, this stream is brought to you in collaboration with these guys over here. This is brought to you by Licklibrary and Guitar Interactive magazine, bringing you the best in not only lessons, but also news, interviews, gear reviews, all that good stuff. You want some of that stuff? Go down here. Go to licklibrary.com for lessons. Go to guitarinteractivemagazine.com for all of the rest. We are talking about three things today that you must practice. Now, must is a very strong word, and we kind of batted this around before we launched this because we felt like it was a little bit clickbaity, and we thought, do we really say must? But really, when we thought about it a little bit deeper, these are three things that you must practice because ultimately, these are the only three things that you can practice. Now, I'm going to elaborate on that as we go a bit further. But first of all, a little word about what we're doing. First of all, if you're a new viewer, hey, welcome aboard. It is great to have you. If you're one of our returning streamers, whichever channel you happen to be watching this on, welcome. It is great to have you on board. Hopefully, we're going to give you some food for thought that's going to elevate your guitar playing today. And we're also going to chat about stuff. If you have any questions, don't be afraid to drop them in the comments. We would love to hear from you. And your questions don't have to be related. I beg your pardon. That is my dinner coming to talk to us. Your questions do not have to be related to the topic of today's lesson. Your questions can be related to anything guitar related, totally whatever is on your mind, and we'll answer those a little bit later on. We're also going to talk a little bit about the lessons that we have available, which are the GI Plus lessons, which will very soon be migrating to licklibrary.com. In fact, it's going to be this week, if I'm not mistaken. So very soon, the lessons that you have been able to access on GI Plus and can still access on GI Plus are going to be available to all of our Licklibrary subscribers too. This includes, but is not limited to lessons by myself, Andy Wood, Tom Quayle, Rick Graham, Michael Caswell, Michelangelo Batio has done some. I think I said Andy Wood. Who else have we missed out? Chris Buck, Ian Simo, Sam Bell, you name it, right? So many great lessons. They're going to be available on licklibrary.com. At some time, I think in the next 7 days, you'll get an email about this to let you know exactly what's going on with that. But if you have any questions, drop an email to playersupport@licklibrary.com. My man Stu Shields is going to pick that up, and he is going to let you know exactly what's going down. Now, we're going to say some hellos to the comment section, then we'll get stuck into the meat of today's lesson. But first of all, before we do that, I want to know from you guys what you think. Let me know in the comments what you think the three things that a guitar player must practice, non-negotiable. What do you think those three things are? And then we'll discuss them in just a little bit. Excuse me, I have a cough mic, which is good because I've still got a bit of a cough. I did attend the Birmingham Guitar Show just recently and talked my voice away, but it's just about back. Anyway, let's check in with the comments. Let's see who's here. Marcin is the first one through the door. Marcin, it is lovely to have you. Thank you so much for joining us. Welcome to our new home. It's not that much different from the old home, but it's good to be here. Anyway, Marcin says, really excited to be here every single Monday. Hope everyone is healthy and well. Me too, my man. I certainly am, and I'm excited to be here too. PJ is in the house, says, hi, Marcin, Nick, and all. A few days off guitar for me. I do a bit of glass blowing. That's pretty cool. And grabbed hold of the wrong torch. Oh, geez. Okay. Wish my fingers would move that fast when they were playing guitar. Well, I wish you a speedy recovery, man. Burns to your playing hands, never fun. We've all done it. We've all had that sort of thing. I recently grabbed a soldering iron, which was no fun at all, let me tell you. Our new friend Mika says, hi all. I've been following these absolutely fabulous next Monday streams for some time now without signing in. Today, I finally decided to join in. Greetings from Cairns. Well, let me tell you, we are over the moon to have you. I'm really glad that you did sign in. Thank you so much for joining us. And welcome to our little community of streamers. It's lovely to have you. And if you are watching this, not signed in, make sure you sign yourself in, drop us a comment, let us know where you're watching from, let us know if you have any questions specifically about any of the lesson stuff we're doing today, but also about anything else that is on your mind. We'll see if we can get them answered for you. Who else do we have in the house? Larry Warren is here. Larry, it's great to have you on board. Response Audio is in the house. Sorry to hear that, PJ, for sure. I totally agree. Sacred Godslayer, our Italian Shred correspondent, is here. Timothy Appling is here and has bought a brand new Gibson SG Extreme. My life. Okay. Always prefer playing my SG, and this one would not quit calling my name. Haven't bought a new guitar since 2019, and that is quite the streak, man. I realized a little while ago I haven't bought a new guitar in absolutely ages, apart from, if you count this guy just up here, see this sunburst acoustic hanging on the wall? That is a 12-string D'Angelico that I bought for £150, brand new. Couldn't resist, but I know how you feel when a guitar won't stop calling your name. You just gotta play it. Now, I think there's some spec in the comments down below. We'll get to that in a wee bit. Response Audio, sounds cool. I like SGs, so do I. Helmet Strap is here. Cranker Tom is in the house. He's pinched his right hand middle finger, so no hybrid picking today. Good job, we got a plectrum to play with. I received Dublin Bohemians FC away jersey with a Thin Lizzy logo on the chest. Now that is super cool, love a bit of that. We got some love for SGs in the comments. If you guys are into the SG thing, let me know. Ken Waller is in the house, says, hi Nick, hi everyone. I hope you like the new name for everyone. Here's my favorite Monday live stream. We are now officially the Nick Jennison Monday Guitar Show. Hey, what are the odds? That's my name, and that's the day that we're doing it, and the thing that we're talking about. So hey, there you go. Subscriber approved, says Timothy Appling. For sure, contributor approved. Mark Crandall, great to have you on board. Michael Horst is tuning in. I think a first time commenter. Michael, lovely to have you. Who else do we have? Let's make sure we've got everyone, and then we'll crack on. Frank is in the house. Who else do we have? Let's very quickly rattle through these. Daryl Queen is here. New name and thumbnail looks tough. It's not super tough, but you know, it's pretty good. Again, shout out to our man Stu Shields for doing the thumbnail design there. Very, very cool work. Who else do we have? Very quickly, Cowcat is in the house, says that Monday logo looks like something is going to happen. Something is indeed going to happen. We have some bets placed on what guitar I'm going to be playing today. We played some PRS for the last few streams. Seemed rude not to pick up the My Back, but fear not, the PRS will be back. We got some love for the PRS, and also an Estevan. Maybe I'll have to get an Estevan. Who knows? I am a lover of affordable guitars, so don't feel like, you know, the affordable guitar thing scares me off in any way. I totally disagree. A lot of love in the comments. Really, really do appreciate that. You guys are great. It's always lovely to have you, right? It'd be very lonely without you, but we always say that. Who else in the house? Dave Baker. Dave, it's good to see you. It says, good to meet you on Saturday at the guitar show. Did you check out the Wynyard Stellcaster? I certainly did. Anybody who was at the Birmingham Guitar Show, by the way, if you didn't check out the Wynyard guitar stand, you missed out. They got some really great guitars. Very, very cool, aged looking JMs and Strats and Tellies, but they do this absolutely mad thing where there's a pick guard that houses stealth pickups. So basically you have to imagine that it's like a one pickup Telecaster, like an Esquire, but it also has a neck pickup hidden under there. In fact, it has two pickups, so you can do the Strat thing too, but you can't see them. It's definitely worth checking out. Wynyard guitars, very, very cool, and they play great as well. D-Mac is in the house. Cranky Loner is here. Lovely to have you. John Mac with a suggestion of the things that we can practice. It says chords, arps, and scales. Well, that is one. There's one little category. We're going to get to that in a wee bit. Who else do we have? A question from Cranky Lona. We will address this a little bit later on. Very cool. Kate Strange says scales. PJ says accuracy. Mark B. Nish says timing. Sacred Godslayer says the first thing subdivisions is the first thing to practice. That's another thing. Dead Man Doogie Van Dugerson says technique, songs, and question mark. You were actually pretty close to the mark, my man. Mike Seedorf is here. Says hand sing, fretboard knowledge, relaxation. We're getting there. Nick Harrison's in the house. Gonna shout out Nick Harrison because this is a concept that I actually got from Nick Harrison, and we're gonna address that in a bit. We're gonna give credit where it's due. Carl Hackman is in the house. Carl, it's great to have you on board. We've got some really good suggestions. Three must practices. Harmony, time feel, repertoire. That's a good one. Justin Ray says definitely rhythm, note values, musicality for sure. Warm up, soloing of chords, shredding. Good suggestions. Suggestions, timing, chords, and fretboard. I agree, rhythmic feel and timing and sync. Lots and lots and lots of these. Must practice slagging off the bass player. That doesn't take much practice, let me tell you. anyway, real great suggestions coming in here, but I am going to reveal the thing for you. So these are the three things that you must practice every time you sit down and play the guitar. And this is a concept, again, that I have taken from my good friend Nick, Nick Harrison, who's in the chat. So you got any questions about the Creative Guitar Performance Workshop, where I have adapted this from, make sure you send Nick a message, right? Because it's just killer stuff. It's quite highbrow, but don't let that put you off. It is really, really great. And I found it very, very valuable. Now, Nick says, I always love it when you share your work. That is good to know, because when it's shared properly with the right people and it's always cited. Hey man, we give credit where it's due. So anyway, let me show you what I'm talking about. There are three things you must practice, because ultimately, all of guitar playing and all of music playing can be boiled down to these three things. Let me show you. We've got a little Venn diagram right about now. The three things in question I have boiled down to, and this is quite a simplistic take on the original one, which was a little bit more, I guess, more comprehensive, but I feel like this is quite guitar player friendly. The three things we must practice are technique, knowledge, and style. These are three things that encompass the entirety of guitar playing. But there is a little bit of a deeper thing going on here, because we have got some little subdivisions here. But let's imagine this for a minute. The three things we've got going on. We have technique. Well, what is technique? Technique, I have put down as accuracy, efficiency, consistency. We often get caught up in the idea that technique is entirely the shred thing. And it's not really. You know, you can't play anything without an appropriately good technique for the thing that you're trying to play. So we have to have our technique on point. This is something that is a must if we're going to play the guitar at all, full stop. Knowledge. Well, what is knowledge in this context? Knowledge is fretboard knowledge. It's an understanding of music theory. It's an understanding of the application of music theory, the traditions of music to an extent. So, you know, you might kind of consider this the what you're going to play. So we have technique. We have knowledge, right? You must know what it is that you're going to play before you can play it. If I said to you, here's a great question, right, from Cranky Loner. Cranky Loner is asking, hey, want to learn about Bark at the Moon, or Barack at the Moon, maybe? Who knows, right? Maybe it's about Obama at the Moon, but Bark at the Moon, I am guessing the Jakey Lee, Ozzy Osbourne song. Great song, right? If you don't know how to play it, and if I said to you, well, the first chord is a slide from, let's get rid of this very, very quickly. If I said to you that the first chord was a slide from 5, 7, and 8 on the G and B strings. And then we slide that up 2 frets. If you didn't know what fret 5 was, you didn't know what the D string was, you didn't know what the G string was, didn't know what the B string was, didn't know what a 2-fret slide was, it's not much good to you. So we have to know some stuff to, in order to play. Now, the other thing that comes along with this is style. Now, style I am broadly referring to as repertoire, expression. This is a very important one from Nick's kind of version of this, which is repertoire and contribution. Repertoire and contribution. So we put contribution in there too. So style is how you interface with music in a whole, right? It's one thing to play some notes. It is entirely another thing to play those notes and have them sound like music. And in order to practice effectively, we have to hit all three of these, because ultimately, all three of these are the core elements of playing the guitar. Now, a bunch of guitar players have talked about this at length. One of my favorite characterizations of this is Steve Vai, who talks about the concept of head, hands, and heart. Well, if that doesn't mean anything, that means head, knowledge, hands, technique, heart, style. Now, here's the cool thing. If you hit something on all three of those points within your practice session, you can rest assured that you have done a little bit of something for every important aspect of playing the guitar, right? I'll say that again. If you touch on all three of those points in your practice session, you have hit upon all three important parts of playing the guitar. So let's talk about how we might practice this stuff. So first of all, what we can do is we can break this stuff down into individual elements and we can practice them one at a time. So let's take a look at how we might practice technique, for example. Well, technique is best done to some kind of timing constraint. I say timing constraint, you might use a metronome, you might use a drum loop. But as far as technique goes, if we were to isolate the playing, the practice of technique, it would be just isolating the physical movement of your hands on the guitar. Now let's talk about the things that are involved in technique. So there are the usual things that we talk about when we come to guitar techniques, which are things like alternate picking, economy picking, sweep picking, hammer-ons and pull-offs, legato technique. That stuff is very important. But there's also things like dynamics. There's things like tonal control. There's things like accuracy, consistency, timing, all these things, not running out of steam, being efficient with your technique, all this sort of stuff is super important. And what we can do is we can devise exercises that tackle many of these aspects all at once. Let's come up with one, right? So let's take a classic exercise that we might use to challenge our technique. And the classic exercise might be something like this. So we're gonna go to this set of cameras for this real quick. Let's do the ever popular spider exercise. Now I will say out front, I don't have a huge dog in the fight with this sort of thing, but this is really one of my least favorite exercises. Right, one of my least favorite exercises. Homeus Home is very keen on warm-up. I'm gonna show some warm-ups a little bit later on, but really warm-up, we'll discuss that a bit later on because we'll get into that, right? Warm-up is important. Preparation for playing is important. But anyway, on a technique thing, a spider exercise. This is one of my least favorites. So what we might get is, there's a reason why we're doing this, by the way. We might get this classic exercise where we play on the low E string, 5, 6, 7, 8, 5, 6, 7, 8, 5, 6, 7, 8. You get the gist. We play it across all of our strings. This is something that is a classic technique exercise. People will say, hey, you wanna get your technique together, just do this spider exercise. We're gonna see if we can make this a little more efficient, right? Mark Crandall is saying snooze. I totally agree, right? Totally agree. So let's play it together. Hopefully you guys can hear those drums. We're gonna begin by playing. Starting on our 5, let's play. Literally the easiest thing in the world, right? But we're gonna use this as a way to demonstrate how we might skin this to challenge our own technique. There's a spider exercise, dead easy, right? Now we can play it like that, but maybe we can try playing a little bit faster and see if we can ramp up the difficulty using speed. If we go, let's try this together. Play one more time. 1, 2, 3. Let's play it together. Dead easy, right? Piece of cake. Let's try it again. Ready? One more time. Here we go. You get the gist, right? It should be the easiest thing in the universe. Shouldn't pose much of a challenge to us at this point. But if we try practicing a little bit faster, let's try going. Still be quite easy. I'd imagine some of you are falling off at this point, and that's okay. It doesn't really matter. Let's go a little bit further. Let's try one more time. Let's go. We're currently 100 BPM. Playing what feels like 16th notes. Let's try 32nd notes. Let's try it together. Ready? 2, 3, 4. Now, unless we're in the Guitar Olympics, we're probably not going to be spending a whole lot of time playing there, but ultimately, this is going to give us a little insight into one of the ways that we can make this stuff challenging for ourselves. We can take exercises, we can scale them by using speed. So if we're trying to work on that technique, we can use speed as a variable to control how difficult an exercise is. Now, in terms of how difficult something should be, we've talked about this before on previous Guitar Interactive streams, where we've discussed this idea of a sweet spot of difficulty, where it's something that you can do reliably, but it poses a challenge. You have to concentrate to do it, but you can still do it. It shouldn't be something where it's like completely impossible. But speed is not the only thing that we can use to challenge our technique. We can challenge our technique by changing the string spacing. We can change the rhythm of what we're playing. We can accent certain notes. We can vary the fingers we're using. We can do all manner of stuff to challenge our technique. So let's generate some exercises together that might be technique heavy, and then we'll move on to some other stuff. So very quickly, some technique stuff. Let's try playing very quickly the same thing again. Here's a spider exercise. But this time what I want to do is I want to take pinky finger and I want to move it. This is just one example. But let's take the pinky finger and let's move it. Let's move the pinky finger down by not one, but two strings. So here what we might play is this. Already that is challenging, right? So let's try playing. We're playing D string. Let's try playing that across all of our string pairs. So let's go. Already a little more challenging. So let's try it again. Let's try going. It does sound like a Primus song, says Daryl Queen. Now, we might come across some cool ideas here when we're doing this, but this is one example of how we might make this a little more difficult. Let's do it on the way down. Same thing. This time, what we're going to do is we're going to go... Same deal, but the middle, the pinky finger is moved by one string. We go... Now, if we play this back and forth, we might get something like this, where we get... And notice how even though speed... is held quite low, we can still make this challenging. The reason I bring this up is just to break this idea in your mind that technique has to be related to speed. It doesn't have to be. What we can also do is we can use technique. When we work on our technique, we can use things like this where it's accuracy related. We can also use things that are maybe dynamic control related. Now for this, we're gonna start to move into this little quadrant. Take a look across here, right? You see this knowledge quadrant here where it's blue. Take a look at the pink quadrant. That is somewhere in between technique and knowledge. Here what we're gonna do is we're gonna use some dynamic control exercises to start accenting certain notes. This is a big Nick Harrison thing, right? So we're gonna start accenting some notes, but we're gonna do it in the context of a scale. This is going to be a way for us to practice both our technique and our fretboard knowledge, because we're going to have to identify certain notes within our scale to accent. Let's try doing an E major scale, first of all, before we do anything. And I'm going to show you this so we can all play along together, right? Let's get rid of that. Let's go to these two cameras. I'm going to throw that backing track on from the intro because that backing track was in the key B major. I'm going to get rid of this little loop. Let me just find it for you one more time. Here we go. This is our ambient ballad. Available on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel, by the way. If you're not subscribed to us already, do so. Let's take a scale. So the scale in question is going to be this. If we play on our A string, 7, 9, and 11, and then over here we go 7, 9, 11 again on the D string, we get this. When we get to our G string, we'll play 8, 9, 11, and we get this. On the highest two strings, we're going to get the following. We're going to get 9, 10, 12, 9, 11, 12. So far we've had this. We get... Now this should be a scale that we should all be able to play along with. It should be fairly easy. We'll go one more time. Now already this scale is something that is posing something of a technical challenge, not a huge challenge, but it may pose a little bit of a challenge to some of us. What we might do here, what we might do next, is we are going to impose a technical challenge on here that is not it's not speed related. We could just play this faster and faster and faster and play things quicker and quicker and quicker. But what if we were to impose perhaps a dynamic control element to this? So a dynamic control might be something where we accent certain notes within our scale. And we're going to begin by accenting E notes. It's nice and easy. Now, where do we find our E notes? Our E notes in question are going to be here at the very bottom of the scale. There's E. There's another E here on the 9th fret on our G string. There's another one right up here on the top on the 12th fret of a high E string. There's an E here, an E here, and an E here. We're gonna see if we can accent those by picking them a little bit harder. Now this is interesting because something a lot of guitar players do without realizing it is we fall into this habit of picking everything really hard. Right, so if we pick everything really hard. If everything is hard, then nothing is hard. And if everything is loud, then nothing is loud. So this not only encourages us to be able to play very loud notes at will, but also encourages us to be able to play quieter notes. Let's try playing this together along with our backing track, and we'll see if we can use this as an exercise, not just to build, our fretboard knowledge so we can learn our E major scale and also learn where all of the E's are in our E major scale, but we also get to challenge our technique without resorting to speed. Let's try something like this, accenting all of the E's. There's one, there's one, there's one. Let's try it together. We're gonna go like this. A bit faster. Again. Now that's interesting in and of itself, but what if we were to expand this further and do some improvisation? So here, if we were to do some improv, using the E major scale, we can play anywhere we want on the fretboard. We're gonna do the same deal, but this time we're gonna be accenting all of the E notes. Anytime we land on an E note, we accent it. An E note, wherever that happens to be, whether it's the open E string, whether it's this E up here. There's nothing special about E's, that's just what we're doing for this exercise. It might look something like this, we might get. That right way is another way to pose a challenge to ourselves without resorting to speed, but we also get to do the following. We get to practice our technique, we get to practice our fretboard knowledge, all at the same time. The only thing we're not really practicing at this point is our style, or are we? We'll get to that, we'll cover that. Now, in terms of why we're practicing both here, this is imposing a technical demand. In the sense, let's go back to our diagram very quickly. It's imposing a technical demand in the sense that we're having to accent certain notes. We have to have the dynamic control to play those notes louder or softer. You might think this is part of style because it is an expressive thing, but it's also a little bit of technical control, because it's one thing to have an expressive outcome in mind, but if you don't have the technical facility to carry it off, it's just not gonna happen. And this idea of dynamics being a technical thing, it fulfills that technical command, technical challenge requirement. Now, knowledge, we're also practicing our fretboard knowledge, not just in the sense that we're practicing scales up and down, but we're also engaging with the scale and trying to recognize which note it is that we're playing within our scale. And as our friend Daryl Queen has rightly pointed out, a sneaky bit of ear training in there too, for sure, right? Now, you could consider ear training, the ability to hear a sound and know how to play it. You consider that a part of knowledge. You consider it a part of style as well, where you're able to hear a sound and emulate its tonal aspects, which is something we're about to get to. So far, we've covered some technique, we've covered some style, right? Well, what about if we were to cover knowledge and style at the same time? Well, first of all, we need to discuss what style is. Now, style can be boiled down to a few things. It can be boiled down to your ability to take otherwise uninteresting sounding notes and make them sound interesting, to have a unique voice on the instrument. It can be your timing, which also falls into knowledge and falls into technique. So timing is all three. You need to have good technique in order to execute things with good timing. You also need to know what the timing is that you're trying to play, but you also you have a sense of style about it. You need to know whether you're laying back on the beat, whether you're laying forward in the beat. What do your heroes do, for example? This is where learning songs becomes really, really useful, even if that's not your primary goal as a guitar player. If your goal is just to master this instrument that we love, you should still be learning songs. So for example, if you really want to know how to make a guitar just like kind of sound rock and roll and amazing, you should probably learn some Jimmy Page solos. You should probably learn some Joe Perry solos if you want to learn how to make something sound smooth and expressive and have beautiful timing and beautiful note duration and all that sort of stuff. You should learn some David Gilmour solos, even if you're maybe a bit of a shredder. Now, this is where your Lick Library membership is going to become very useful, because we've got like 70 classic albums that you can go and learn note for note, start to finish. So if you want to learn songs, go to licklibrary.com, go get them. They're really useful. Of course, that's not the only thing that's available in Lick Library. There's tons of technique lessons, fretboard knowledge courses, any of the stuff that you want help with, any of the extra resources you need, you'll find them as part of your Lick Library membership. You'll also find a whole bunch of this stuff in GI Plus, including, but not limited to, this one course that I want to show you right now. This is a course on the subject of expressiveness, which we're going to discuss when we come back. So our expressiveness boils down to how we color notes. Now, in terms of coloring notes, it's the idea of taking a phrase that maybe sounds something like this. Let's go to our backing track, treat ourselves to a little bit of overdrive and a bit of delay. If we were to play something like this, sounds kind of rubbish. If we were to keep it on the same settings, let's not cheat, and let's do something like this. Sounds more like music. Now, we'll be going into this today, but before we do, let me show you the course that we have in this. This is a course called Expressive Techniques Part 1. GI Plus members can already access this. Lick Library members, you'll be getting this when GI Plus merges with Lick Library very, very soon. Any questions about this, send your email to playersupport@licklibrary.com. You're just going to get it. It's going to appear in your membership one day, and you'll have full access to it. It's great. Anyway, check it out. When we come back, we'll talk about how you can practice this stuff. Hi guys, Nick Jennison with Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. Does your playing sound like this? When really you'd like it to sound like this? Now, the difference between these two examples are not the notes that are being played, but rather the way the notes are being played. I'm sure you've heard this before. Guitar players will say to you, it's not what you play, it's how you play it. And when it comes to creating interesting, emotive, and musical sounding guitar lines, that is very much the case. And in this course, Expressive Techniques Part 1, we aim to equip you with the tools to sound more musical, more emotive, more interesting, and ultimately more expressive on the guitar. And we are going to do this by exploring the three principal left-hand expressive techniques, which are slides, bends, and vibrato. I'm going to show you the mechanics of these techniques and how you can execute them cleanly, efficiently, and reliably. I'll also give you some exercises to help develop these techniques. And we're also going to discuss some musical applications, how you might use these techniques in your own playing. We're going to go into great depth with that stuff. And I'm also going to give you a solo study, a piece of music I've prepared. And I'm going to encourage you and kind of guide you through the process of applying expression to an otherwise expressionless and bare sounding piece of guitar playing. So at the end of this course, you are going to be able to take otherwise uninteresting and fairly dry pieces of music and turn them into expressive, colorful, musical lines. And you're also going to be able to take this and apply it to your own playing or to other people's music that maybe you're playing and you want to express in your own way. This is Expressive Techniques Part 1. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive GI Plus. I hope you'll join me. I will see you in there. So there you go, guys. That is one of the courses that will soon be dropping on licklibrary.com. It is part of your GI Plus membership. If you're already a GI Plus member, of course, you know about this course. If you're a Licklibrary member, you're going to be getting this very, very soon. Let's talk about it. Let's talk about the style thing, how we're going to practice it. So a quick reminder, style is repertoire, expression, contribution. Contribution being an important one. Contribution is what are you adding to the rich tapestry of music, the rich tapestry of guitar playing that already exists? And if you're not, why aren't you? You're perfectly qualified. Had a cough coming on. Perfectly qualified, as is every other guitar player, to add to the musical canon that is the guitar. You do not need to wait until you're, Nick pointed out, Steve Lukather, as an example of this, you don't need to wait until you're Steve Lukather to contribute. Write songs, improvise solos, right? Write little pieces of music. You can contribute, you're allowed to, it's okay, right? Nobody says you're not, anybody says you're not is wrong. I don't often say people are wrong, but if people say you're not allowed to make music, they're wrong. Anyway, so let's talk about how we're gonna practice this. So thus far, we've done some practice that has challenged our technique. We've done some practice that has challenged our fretboard knowledge. What about practice that's going to challenge our style? Well, here's a few things we might do. We can take some licks and we can learn them, right? This is really good fun. Take some licks and learn them. This is a great way to improve your vocabulary as a guitar player. But really important is don't just learn the lick. Don't just learn the lick. Try and make the lick sound the way that you want it to sound. So let's take some examples, right? If we go to the big filthy gain sound and we use the example of something like the, I keep using this one because John Sykes is a great example for this. If we take this lick, for example, from Is This Love, it's a really great lick. I'm not gonna teach you the lick, but these lessons are coming, right? So if we play, now, ways we can make this sound like John Sykes. Let's begin by playing it without styling it. Doesn't sound terribly John Sykes-y, the tone's pretty good, but if we play this, sounds immediately more Sykes-esque. We don't have to make it sound like John Sykes. We could take the same lick, we could make it sound more like, let's imagine if Gary Moore was gonna play it. We might play something like this. What's the difference? The difference is in the touch, the difference is in the vibrato, the difference is in the pickup selection. What I'm getting at with this is when you are learning songs, this is one of the best reasons why you shouldn't be learning songs just from tab, by the way. Just throwing that out there, right? When you're learning songs, learning licks, it's not just about learning the notes and playing the notes. That's a very small part of it. But really what we're looking for here is your ability to take those notes and express them in, first of all, the way that the original artist intended, but also in the way that you want to express them. Right? Are you able to take a note and make it aggressive? Are you able to make it languid and singing? Are you able to make it sorrowful? Are you able to play it quietly with a soft touch? Are you able to make it sing and soar or scream or whatever? Are you able to make it short? Are you able to make it long? Are you able to make it vocal or percussive? Or all of these other things that aren't just about playing the note. Now, this is one of the reasons why the lesson tuition that we have on songs over at Licklibrary is so great, because we don't just teach you the notes, we teach you how to play the thing. So anyway, what I'm gonna encourage you to do is you might imagine some of your favorite guitar players and see if you can play some stuff in their idiom and try and listen to them and work out what it is that makes them sound the way they do. It's actually not that hard to do, but we are here to help you if that, you know, if that's something you want. So say, for example, we took, one of my favorite guitar players in the modern era is Chris Buck. I can't play like Chris, but I've gleaned a few things from his style. So for example, things like this, right? If we try and inject a little bit of that into our E major improvisation, we might go looking for something like this. Thank you. once again, should stress, I cannot play like Chris, right? Nobody can play like Chris, but I have gleaned a few things from there that have become a part of my little voice, right? And my little voice, which are some of these little slides, some of these little vibrato techniques, the bending thing. Now, if I was to hone in on one particular aspect of that, I might take this particular aspect. And this is a little trick that I'm gonna show you. This is something that we call, or rather I call, the little Chris Buck slide, or the Chris Buck fret cross, or something like that, whatever you wanna call it. So let me show you what I'm talking about. This is a little trick that you hear a lot of guitar players do, and it's inspired by slide guitar players, among other things, but also soul singers, for example. What we might do, if we take our E major pentatonic scale, if we take the idea of bending from 11 up to 13 on the G string, we can bend that, we can release it. What we could also do is we can bend and release, and on the release, we can very quickly slide up one fret and back down again. It's like a little flip that singers will do in their voice. It's really nice. Now, how long this is and how far we go across the fret is going to determine how it sounds. It sounds a bit clumsy. That. Pretty. What makes that pretty and what makes this clumsy? It's the duration that we spend on this side of the fret. How do we know that? Well, we know that because I practiced it, and A, because I'm kind of telling you, that's okay, but I discovered this by improvising, exploring that idea at length. So what I made is I made this a focus for myself, and I did some improv where I went, okay, I'm going to practice primarily playing this little trick, and every time I bend, I'm gonna do that little slide thing to get across the fret and back again when it's time to release the bend. So what that might look like for me, I'll throw my big lead sound back on because it's sounding pretty good tonight, so it might look like this. Well, it won't look like that. Now that, again, is just some improv. It's literally just some improv. I'm making stuff up, but I'm using this as my focus. Now, what does this challenge me on? Let's figure it out. Challenges me on the following. Challenges me on my ability to play with style, because I'm focusing on a particular stylistic element, which in this case is the bend and string cross, the Chris Buck thing. It's challenging my technique, because I need to be able to execute this cleanly and accurately. I need to make sure that my strings aren't ringing out when I'm playing. I need to make sure that the bend is in tune, or in tune in a way that I like. So we talked before on previous streams about how tuning is, I'm not gonna say tuning is a myth, but we'll use that clickbait title in the future, so do be aware of it. How tuning is not always what it appears to be, let's say. But you know, what we might also challenge ourselves with in this case is how quickly I can get that little whippy slide to do its thing. It's also challenging on my fretboard knowledge, because I have to know what I'm bending, where I'm bending to. I have to know what note I'm reaching for. I have to know which frets are available to me to play. I have to have a rhythmic idea in mind. It's also developing my vocabulary, because in the process, I'm doing a little bit of a conscious audit of the things I'm playing and going, oh, I like that, didn't like that, did like this, didn't like that so much, etc. The reason I bring this up is this should serve to highlight that when we say there are three things you must practice, and really only three things you can practice, you can kind of do them all at once, and you can take your practice ideas and just kind of skin them so that you're getting something out of all three of these pots. And this is cool, because what it means is it takes this big task of learning the guitar, this big business of like all this stuff that I've got to learn. I have to learn scales and arpeggios and bending and picking technique and timing and licks and songs and stuff, and distills it down to three very easy boxes that you have to tick. And if you tick those three boxes, you can rest assured that you have done the right thing for your practice. Your practice is good. Now, there are other aspects to this. There are things like having a plan, having some exercises that you develop that you pursue consistently so you can see progress. There are having goals, all that sort of stuff. That's all great, but we're talking about individual sessions here. Every time you sit down to practice, if you get something in all three of these boxes, you can consider it a win. And if you are playing something and it doesn't have one of those boxes ticked, you can very easily find a way to introduce some of that. So if you want to practice your technique, for example, you can very easily throw in some fretboard knowledge in the mix by challenging yourself to play things where you don't know them on the fretboard. So we were talking about, there's been some questions for outside playing, for example. Some folks are saying they don't like the pentatonic scale. Which pentatonic scale? I'll pose to you, because there are many pentatonic scales. But if we want to explore some technical problems, let's say we wanted to explore maybe some three note per string picking ideas, and we don't want to do it with the traditional three note per string ideas, we could easily pick another scale and do it with. We could do something with a half whole diminished, for example. Let's find a track that is conducive to that. I've definitely got one. This one's good fun. This is in D, and it's in 7/8, for those of you who are asking for weird stuff. It's originally supposed to be vaguely in the style of Tool, but it's kind of not. So what I could do here is I could play, instead of running scales like this, this is just for you weirdos out there who want weird scales, instead of playing, I can easily turn it into this. All the silly stuff. All we're doing there is, because folks were asking, right, you can combine all of this stuff all at once, is what I'm trying to say, right? And that's kind of the thrust of this idea, the thrust of this session, is these are the three big boxes you have to tick. If you move all of those big rocks within a single session, you can call it a good session. So let's look at some multiple ways you could do this. You could improvise with some constraints. You could do some dedicated technique work and then do some exploration of the fretboard. You could learn some songs and really try and get under the skin of what's being played. Don't just learn the notes, but try and suss out the patterns that are being played and the chords and how the notes relate to them. And also you could play some songs that are challenging for your technique in the pros. Learning songs is great. You could you could write a song. You could write a piece of music, an etude, and see how many ways you can pull it before it breaks. You can play something you already know, and you can try and style it different ways. All manner of stuff that you can do that is gonna tick all three of these big boxes and more. So hopefully, guys, what I'm trying to get from this session is, fingers crossed, what we're getting here is we're getting an insight into how much there is out there, but also how you can very easily tackle it all by just focusing on these big three aspects. And as long as your practice has something like that in it, I think you're good to go. So it's time to move on to some questions. If you have some questions, then what was the last three note strings? I honestly couldn't tell. Oh, the last three note per string scale. It was half whole diminished is what we were doing. Half whole diminished. Incidentally, by the way, we'll do this. I'm going to answer your question because we have some questions about outside playing, all sorts of stuff. So you guys have been asking questions. I promise I haven't been ignoring you. We're going to get to them right about now. So if you're new to what we're doing here, every week we do a Q&A session where we answer your questions. So if you have questions, drop them in the comments. We'd love to hear from you, but we've got some good ones already. Got a whole bunch of them started up. We're going to answer a few of them as we go. So first of all, let's get to this one. This is a really cool one from Cranky Lonet, who's saying, how do you apply legato for melodies? So here's how I apply legato for melodies in terms of using it for melodic playing. So legato, for anybody who's unsure, legato is the, as far as the guitar goes anyway, legato technique is playing using hammer-ons and pull-offs. Now, the distinction that has to be made here, because the distinction is there is legato the sound, which is playing joined up and smooth, and there is legato the technique that we use in the guitar, which is hammer-ons and pull-offs. And that's what we're going to talk about. So to my mind, the hammer-on and pull-off is a really great way to get a note that doesn't sound like there's a clack at the start. Let me show you what I'm talking about. So very quickly, with my, let's go to a slightly less gained out sound. If I play a little melody on the, let's pick our E major pentatonic scale again. If I play this, and I pick every note, it all has a little bit of a clackety, clackety, clackety at the start. Now, if we're playing melodic stuff, what we can do is we can use hammer-ons and pull-offs, i.e. where we take a note and then we press our finger, or rather, strike our finger very firmly on a higher note that causes the string to strike the next fret. It's a very important distinction. It's not actually the finger that makes the noise. It's the string hitting the fret that makes the noise. We can use this to create a smoother sound that doesn't have the attack. Listen to this. Hear that clack? Or lack thereof, same with pull-offs. Pull-offs, in case you're wondering, are just a little pluck or a brush with your left hand. Dead easy. We're playing this note. We brush with this finger, pinky finger, to make this note come out. We can do it without striking this note first. We can just go like this. That's a fun thing to practice, but as far as melodic playing goes, I use this as a way to make notes sound smooth and soft, let's say. Make them sound smooth and flowing versus the clack of a pick. You might think about this as vowels and consonants in speech. If you ever listen to, you ever watched any of the old Star Trek, let's say, and listen to the way the Klingons speak and they have this kind of thing going on. Not the most pleasant sound in the whole world, but sometimes it's the sound we want. But other times we want something smooth. So if we take a melody and I pick every note, that's the wrong one. Let's not do the Tool backing track. Let's do the Ambient Ballad backing track, because that was pleasant. I'll just get rid of that one and we'll fire this one back up. Where's my Ambient Ballad? Because we're talking about melody stuff. So what I might do is, instead of playing this, let's go, actually, you know what it is? Let's go to these cameras so we can see both hands. Already some pull-offs in there, but let me show you. If we take that approach where I'm not picking every note, we just put some pull-offs in there. We get to control how smooth or how clacky and attacky our note is. Now, in terms of when to do this, that's really up to you. And you discover this in your style practice, which can involve listening to how your favorite guitar players do this and emulating them, or it can involve just experimenting with it and finding ways that you like. If there's something that falls easily under your hand and you go, that's quite an easy place to do that and I like the way it sounds, run with it. If you have a particular sound in mind and you want to know how a particular guitar player is doing that, take a listen, figure it out, or check out a lesson on the subject. Definitely, definitely worth taking a look at. So that's how we apply legato to melodies. Hopefully that's answered your question. Next up, our new friend, Homeus Home, says, how do I avoid pentatonic? I just hate it. Well, let's first of all say that there are many pentatonic scales, not just the good old-fashioned minor or major pentatonics, and maybe you'll find one that you really love. For example, I have a course on the topic, available on licklibrary.com, called Creative Pentatonics Part 1, where we explore how you can make modal sounds with pentatonics. But let me show you one fun way to avoid the pentatonic that is literally just avoiding the pentatonic, right? And by literally, what I mean is just playing the pentatonic that is a semitone out. This is one of my favorite ways to get immediately into the outside thing, because outside thing is fun. I will say we're going to use this sparingly, but we'll talk to that in a minute. Let's go back to that Tool style backing track. So we're going to be in D minor here. Let me show you this very quickly. We'll go to these two hands cams. D minor pentatonic. We can use D minor pentatonic as a way to avoid D minor pentatonic, if that makes sense. There's our D minor pentatonic box one. Now, what is the furthest scale away from D minor pentatonic? Well, ironically, in terms of the content of notes within, it's probably E flat minor pentatonic, or the scale that's one semitone up, because it doesn't share any of the same notes as D minor pentatonic. Watch what happens when we briefly step into E flat minor pentatonic over our D minor pentatonic. There's D minor. Did you catch that? You might be wondering, what on earth was that? That was E flat minor pentatonic played next to D minor pentatonic. Very, very outside. Cool sound. That's just a fun way to get it, and it's an instant way to avoid the pentatonic scale by literally avoiding it. Like, as in avoid it as in the way you'd avoid someone in the street. You just step out to one side. Hopefully, that's answered your question. We've got some more cool questions coming in. Let's see how many of these we can get through. So, here's a cool one from Daryl Queen. He's asking, can we get some future lessons on diminished scale ideas and applications? Certainly can, but let me show you one of my favorite ways to do this. One of my favorite ways. To address the diminished scale thing, because the diminished scale thing is really, really fun. So we're going to go back to that idea, but we'll use this idea as kind of a continuum of scales that we might think of as moving from, this might get a little highbrow for a second, moving from pentatonic to Dorian. So we've already talked about this. In case you want any help with that, we have a GI Plus course called Mastering Modes Part 1, where we take the pentatonic scale and we move it from pentatonic into Dorian. Let's do this in the key of C, because I have a fun backing track that's going to work really well for this. This is a C Dorian backing track, and it's nice and heavy and nice and slow. And I think it's the one that is in the trailer. I believe it is. There you go, it's the Mastering Modes thing. So, diminished scale stuff. Very quickly, here's a fun thing to do. That's a very cool comment from Michael Horst. We'll tag that up in a wee bit. So, let's go to the two hands cams. Check this out. So, C minor pentatonic. Dead easy. If we reduce the sixth and the ninth, we get Dorian. Now what we can do is a little bit of a cool cheat, is in this C minor, we can replace C Dorian momentarily with C half whole diminished. The reason for this is we still have, contained within C half whole diminished, the majority of a minor pentatonic. I say the majority because we don't have fourths. We have sharp fours instead, but we can get this. Some sidestep on there as well for good measure. I think my guitar's going a little bit out of tune. That's okay, we're playing some outside stuff, so it's fine. What about if we get this? Here's Dorian. Thank you. pentatonic to apologize. So, a bit wandery, but you get the idea. It's going a little bit, out there, but you did ask. So anyway, we've got another cool question. It's not really so much a comment, but here we go. Fantastic, right? To play in a band, have a good guitar teacher, and be a Licklibrary member is the best advice. Michael Horst, we should put you on the payroll. Because 100%, right? So what I will say with this is I feel like, excluding the fact that I think being a Licklibrary member and a GI Plus member, because it's the same thing now, is one of the best things you can do for your guitar playing, I would say that I'm biased, right? So you can discount that. But I think don't, because it's great. It's a really good bit of advice. But even still, right, having some kind of rich resources available to you, also being around or having a mentor figure who can guide you in your guitar practice. By the way, did you know we do one-to-one lessons as part of your Licklibrary membership? If you want some guitar tuition, go see Stu Shields about it. He'll do you some lessons. It'll be really, really great. And also playing with other musicians. These are some of the absolute best things you can do for your guitar playing. I will totally agree with you there. Totally, 100% agree with you. So anyway, last one from Cranky Loner. I do, in fact, love Crazy Train. Although it's not my favorite song on that album. Favorite song on that album is probably I Don't Know. I mean, come on, like, yeah. So good, right? So good. Incidentally, we have the whole of that album, note for note, by Sam Bell on licklibrary.com. Anyway, listen, guys. It has been a pleasure. It's been an absolute joy sitting and talking about the guitar with you today. This has been the first edition of the Monday Guitar Show with me, Nick Jennison. It's been a absolute joy, a whole hour chatting about the guitar. It's great, right? If you've been a regular viewer from when we initially started these in the Guitar Interactive channel, man, thanks for coming back, right? It's great to have you on board. Same place, different place. So anyway, if you're a new viewer, also want to thank you for coming aboard. It has been great having you guys on. I'm going to play some more. I think we'll jam a little bit on that C Dorian backing track because that's pretty cool. But we do this every Monday. So in case you're wondering, we're going to be here every Monday. We'll be doing full sessions like this. Warm up was the question. Okay, very quickly, right? Very quickly. I said this, right? Because he said, bro, warm up. Let me tell you what a warm up is, right? A warm up is just an exercise that is played at a difficulty that is not difficult enough to be challenging. It's just difficult enough to get you prepared. So if this is challenging, too challenging, then this is a warm-up. Take your favorite exercises, make them easier by making them slower, making the difficulty less difficult, and you have a warm-up. That's all there is to it, right? We don't need specific stuff. That's all there is to it. Anyway, listen, guys, thank you so much for having me. My name's Nick Jennison. I will see you next week. We're going to be here every Monday, 8 p.m. UK time, on whichever of the two channels you happen to be watching this on. I will see you next week. Give this video a like, subscribe to whatever channel you happen to be watching on, subscribe to both channels, share this with your guitar playing friends. Don't forget to hit the bell icon so we can let you know when we're about to go live. We'll see you next week with more guitar playing goodness. But in the meantime, let's do some horrible stuff in C Dorian. Here we go. We'll be right back. Hi, my name's Nick Jennison, and it's my pleasure to announce that GI Plus, the exclusive lesson platform from Guitar Interactive magazine, is moving to licklibrary.com. GI Plus features a whole host of the best players and educators in the world, bringing you exclusive lessons on everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag? Well, how about a full-length country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful. Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Members also get access to every lesson ever published in Guitar Interactive magazine, including Michael Caswell's legendary Pro Concepts column. Or maybe you want to learn the secrets of the masters. Well, members get access to over 70 full-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Slash, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. And you get all of this in addition to all of the amazing content on licklibrary.com, which includes note-for-note tuition of over 60 classic albums, weekly lesson uploads, a backing track library, and one-to-one player support. There has never been a better time to sign up than right now.